Buddy, it's Christina Quick, the Tarot Biz Mentor here from the Profitable Psychic Business and Divination Academy. Welcome to today's video. Welcome to February. I hope that you guys are just as excited about Valentine's Day as I am. You know, Valentine's Day is a really, really big holiday for our industry. So we are in the psychic industry, psychic readings, psychic life coaching, that sort of thing. And something that you're going to notice if you've been doing this for any bit of time is that psychic readings and their clients, they tend to attract a lot of people who are looking for love and relationship advice. So I would say when you're on the psychic hotlines, at the very least, love and relationships are going to probably be around 80% of your readings that you're going to be doing, at least in the very beginning, especially at the lower rates. When you transition to setting up your own psychic reading store, say you're on Etsy or you have your own, you know, shopfront, whatever, you're going to notice that those numbers will carry over, but they're not going to be as much. I would say still, I mean, if you're working as a tarot reader, is just a tarot reader or just a psychic, meaning you're not doing spiritual life coaching at this point, you're probably going to find that a lot of your readings, probably 60%, are going to be love and relationship based. Do you have to do love and relationship readings to be a successful psychic? No. But I do feel that it is a really big part of the customer base. If you're not going to do love and relationship readings, then my recommendation would be to actually start investing in courses and, you know, knowledge pertaining to self-love, because that's going to be a really, really big theme as well. And that's when we start moving more into the spiritual life coaching arena. You're still going to have clients that want to come to you to manifest a romantic relationship or to repair a relationship. I know some spiritual life coaches who specialize in that. I know some who specialize in divorce and life after divorce. And you know, there's many, many facets and aspects to it. But what you're going to notice is that the words soulmates and twin flame are going to come up a lot. There's really no way to avoid this. Everybody kind of has their own idea of what soulmates and twin flames are. Some of those ideas are very, very misguided. And so there's a lot of resistance and hesitancy on a lot of the side of the professional psychics. A lot of them don't want to do readings around soulmates and twin flames, which that's your prerogative. If you don't want to do it, that's perfectly fine. You don't have to do it to be successful. But I do feel like there's a lot of misguided sort of opinions and perspectives that go towards soulmates and twin flames. And I know some psychics are very even much against soulmates and twin flames, and they think it's all bunk and everything like that. Well, I'm not really here to change your minds, and I'm not here to try to encourage you to do anything that you don't want to do, but I am here to tell you that if you are actively resisting the whole soulmate and twin flame thing, you may find that it's kind of inevitable that this is a lesson that's going to keep coming back around in your life professionally until you kind of learn how to deal with soulmates and twin flames in a way that is good for you, good for your spirit, good for your soul, good for your work, your values, your beliefs, your ethics, all those sorts of things, right, that are wrapped up into our work. So I figured we would do a series on soulmates and twin flames. I happen to be in a twin flame relationship, so I have a very positive opinion about soulmates and twin flames. But that's my lived-in experience, right? And I feel like you guys maybe could utilize a more positive, optimistic perspective towards this topic. And I happen to be someone who lives in a, who's in a twin flame relationship for almost 20 years. And so I feel like perhaps I have some insight and wisdom about this that I could share with you and maybe just give you guys some alternate ideas or open you guys up to maybe, you know, not seeing soulmates and twin flames as this overly negative thing. Surely it can be very consuming, and it does tend to attract people with codependency issues and things like that, but that in itself is a client problem and not necessarily a soulmate twin flame problem, if that makes sense. So, where to start? Well, we could start with, where did soulmates and twin flames even come from? Where does this come from? You know, it seems like you can't go anywhere and be in any spiritual community or join any tarot reading groups or anything like that, or listen to anybody talk about reading tarot cards or psychic advising without being inundated with some kind of information regarding soulmates and twin flames. And it's very, very, very popular. And why is it so popular? Where does it come from? It feels like it's maybe this new phenomena that's just come around, but no, it's not. It's actually quite an ancient idea. So my mystical and magical metaphysical traditions place me more in the Western camp. This means that I do take some influences from, you know, Eastern philosophies, like yoga is a very, very big part of my life. I was really into Buddhism there for a while, and I learned some really awesome philosophies. But at my core, my tradition that I always go back to is my ancestral traditions, which are mainly Western. And these are also systems that are really integrated with, say, systems like the Golden Dawn, right? And using more Greek kind of philosophy as the basis of the magical systems, right? So there are two main points that I'm going to talk about today in this video. Surely there are many, many, many more. And if you know of any myths or traditions or cultures that have some sort of belief around an idea sort of like soulmates or twin flames, feel free to comment below because I would love to know more about them. But I'm going to talk about two in particular that seem to be very pervasive in Western culture. So the first one that I think that most people can relate to as far as being aware of the story is the story of Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. This is a Judaic myth that later, you know, evolved into Christian mythology. It's also part of the Muslim tradition. So it's an Abrahamic mythos, if you will. So I have actually talked a little bit about this in one of my previous videos, the four selling secrets, I think, of Lilith in your natal moon chart. So check that out if you want to hear more about the story as it relates to Lilith. But today we're going to talk actually more about Eve. So first and foremost, I don't identify as Christian, but I do see value in learning the mythologies around certain religions because it gives us from an anthropological and sociological perspective a better idea about what is going into these spiritual beliefs, where are they coming from, how have they evolved and changed throughout time. So the first one is Adam and Eve in the garden. So as we know from that previous video, Adam and Lilith were created as the first two human beings in the Garden of Eden, and they were created from the same clay, meaning that they were created from the equal components. And Lilith was more so required to take a more submissive role to support Adam's vision of being, the guardians of the earth and having dominion over earth. Well, Lilith decided that she wanted to run her own kingdom and she didn't want to be submissive to Adam. She had her own thoughts and ideas and visions for the future. And so she was casted out and she went off to create her own kingdom. And so this left Adam without a wife. Now, when Adam, when God was coming to see what was going on and decided that, you know, Adam needed another partner because this is how things are done, productivity wise, we need to populate the earth, right? So he created, instead of creating a divine feminine counterpart from the clay like he did with Lilith, he's like, I'm going to instead this time create a counterpart, divine feminine counterpart for Adam from his rib. And so we have this idea of one being separated into two beings and them being a divine counterpart from one another. Now, we also see this in the Greek mythos, right? So many of you are probably very familiar with the Greek mythos. So we have in the beginning, there are all these terrible giants and all of these terrible titans, and they're as big as mountains and as big as planets, right? And from those titans becomes Zeus and his brothers and sisters, which later form the pantheon of Mount Olympus, right? The Olympians. So Zeus is spawned from Kronos, which is like Father Time, the main god, right? And from there, he defeats Cronus, takes over as king, basically, and wipes out most of the giants and these terrible trolls and things like that. And from that point, he said, well, we need to repopulate the earth, right? So kind of a similar situation as Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. And so the first humans that Zeus created were very, very powerful beings. They are described, this is from Plato's Symposium, by the way. If you're curious about where this reference is coming from, it's from Plato's Symposium, which is basically like a collection of stories from different prophets and scholars of that day, talking about the nature of existence, okay? Excuse me. And so these first beings that Zeus created were fearsome creatures. They were very strong. They are said to have two heads and two sets of arms and two sets of legs. And they were, you know, kind of looking like spider people. It kind of makes me think of that, right? But when he created these beings, they were so well created and so efficient that they had no need for a god. They had, because what does Zeus really want? He wants to be worshipped, right? He wants to be needed. So vain, right? And so Zeus decided, these creatures are not even praying to me. They're not dependent on me for anything. What, you know, we have to do something about this. So he charges Apollo, the sun god, to Apollo with the little, not Helios, excuse me, Apollo has the little wings, the little Mercury god, okay? And so he charges Apollo with this sword, I think made out of the sun, and he says, Apollo, you will go around and you will split all of these beings in half. So Apollo does. He goes around with the sword and splits everybody in half. And so now everybody's walking around with just one set of arms, one set of legs, one heart, one head. Well, this still didn't really fix the issue, because what happened was, is they became very depressed. They were missing their other half. They became depressed. They started dying out. And so Zeus, at his wit's end, was like, okay, third time is the charm, right? What do I have to do? So what he ended up doing was he felt pity for these creatures that he created. And what he did is he created that each individual counterpart would then have its own set of parts, and he would face them to the front so that when these beings would come across one another and embrace and try to find their wholeness. Their parts would be front and center, and so that they could at least take pleasure in that, right? So it comes from this idea that in Plato's Symposium, that we are just these beings that are cut in half, and we're wandering the world aimlessly looking for the our other half that we were born with. And that's kind of where this whole idea that twin flame is like, you only have one twin flame, and you know, it's only one person, and it's like this once in a lifetime thing. None of those things are actually true. And it's my pleasure to, you know, continue on with this series and kind of explain that there's a lot of misconceptions about twin flames and soulmates, but this is where a lot of the mythos has actually come from. So I would love to hear from you. Did you find this interesting? Did you know about this? Also, do you have any other mythos or traditions or anything within your own culture that lends to this idea of soulmates and twin flames? And I will see you in the next video. In the next video, we are going to talk a little bit more about soulmates, and we're going to talk about the idea of soul families. So I'll see you in the next video.